So now time to hear the word of God. This morning we have Pastor Daniel Kuilan with us. He's from the pastor of Seoul, a church in Alostar, so they travel a long way down. And he has a beautiful wife, Carolyn, together here in our midst, with two children, Isla and Kael. And in addition, he's also the host of a podcast called Soul Food. They dive into conversations that help us, our views on certain habits, as well as behaviors that take place in our culture. Over to you, Pastor Daniel.
Good morning, church. Oh, he's still sleeping. Yeah, good morning, church. Thank you so much for having me, my wife, and my team is here together. Can we give them a big hand? Ming Kwan, Celine, and Tasha as well. Auntie Pamela, thank you for sharing the story and also encouraging everyone to be... Where's Auntie Pamela? Yeah. Suddenly, I get it. Ah! I am the byproduct of really tasty cha bee hoon. And because of the cha bee hoon, I learn more about Jesus. Because of the lasagna that this auntie made, I'll never forget, I begin to learn and appreciate more about God and how to love others. So I want to tell you, aunties and uncles, hosting is something very important. And the food that you make, and it's funny, right? We as Malaysians, we remember the food. Like, I have a face of the auntie who makes the best cha bee hoon in church. I have the face of the auntie who makes the best, like, chicken soup and ABC soup. Like, you know. And I want to tell you, as a young person, when we are down and not feeling well, we remember that uncle and auntie. So all of us, we have a part to play in the kingdom of God. And everybody say, all right. So thank you so much, Auntie Pamela, for sharing that and encouraging all the ladies here as well. And of course, men, we got our part to play. 6:30 at the gate, Uncle Vincent. I will learn from you. Salute, man. All right, good morning, everybody. I come all the way from Alostar to the team. I've got a couple of photos to share with you guys. If we can go to the screen, Debbie. Next slide. So this is my wife and my two children, Isla and Kyle. 8 years old and 4 years old. Unfortunately, they are unable to join us for this trip because it's second week of school. And my daughter is in one of the harder vernacular school, Chinese school, right? So thank you, Jesus, for Popo that can help her and all of that. Now, by the way, if you're curious, I'm half Indian and half Chinese. So Chindian. Any Chindians here? It's okay. I'm the only one. Special a bit. All right. Next photo. This is our community back in Alostar. This was our Christmas gathering. Really, by the grace of God and challenging our young people, they reach out to about 120 plus young people, and about 60 of them are non-Christian. So, can we give God a big hand? Coming for the first time to a church environment. Next slide, please. So we had our Christmas gathering. We had Pastor Andy. I'm sure many of you know Pastor Andy Yeo. Came all the way and supported us and shared the word of God as well. And this last year was pretty significant because there is a private university in Alostar. For many years, I think we've been trying to connect with them. Finally, this year, the students are coming. So they're African students and Pakistani students. They're joining us as well. So let's give God a big hand. Really amazing what God is doing. Next photo. So these are some of the students praying. Okay, let's move forward a bit more. This is our regular community. We meet every Friday evening. We are called Seoul, based in Alostar, like was mentioned. NLCC, from the bottom of my heart, my wife and I want to thank you for your generosity. It is because of your generosity, Uncle Simon, Auntie Jack as well, together with the team, that you have given us the edge to really push, to really work harder for our city. So thank you so much. So NLCC, please give yourself a big hand. We really, really appreciate it. Okay, next photo. This is our Instagram. It's called Soul Malaysia. And it doesn't matter for you, not just young people, uncle, aunties as well. I know you got Instagram and Facebook. So if you follow us, I just have a very small, not just small, a big request. Whenever you see this account on your feed, can you just take like 10 seconds and pray for us? And just say, God, help this crazy couple back in Alostar. They need you. All right? Can you guys do that? All right. So this is our Instagram. And then next is our podcast. I believe in conversations, and conversations really inspire connections and hope with people. So in this podcast, I talk to various guests, psychologists, pastors, young people, trying to understand what's happening in our world today. And one of the topics that I talk about is actually the culture in our city. So we address mental health issues, relationship issues, and a culture as well. And one of the episodes on culture, we talk about how sometimes we are in an environment that we are so comfortable, and it becomes unintentional that we actually push people away. And so sometimes I've talked to people before, and interestingly, and it's unintentional again. I've heard people leaving church because they weren't included in the conversation. Now, maybe for some of us, we'd be like, what are you talking about? You know, but can you imagine? I as a Chindian or Indian here, and can you imagine unintentionally suddenly 5 or 10 people start speaking Cantonese or Hokkien or Mandarin? Naturally, I will feel left out. And naturally, there's this instinct. Are they talking about me? Because why aren't you speaking English? Why are you speaking Cantonese or Mandarin? But for us, just talk about it, right? We're just having a conversation. So unintentionally, we have been creating exclusivity in church. So these are some of the things that we're talking about. So if you have time, do listen and support us as well. So are you guys still okay here in this place? I thought I'd just give you all an introduction. Of course, the Impact Youth. What's up, guys? Thank you, Joel. You're the most excited one here. Hey, thank you for leading us in worship, man. That's good stuff. Let us pray. God, we thank you for this morning. As we dive into your word, God, help us to understand you better, to understand your heart. In your name we pray. And everybody say, amen. One of my favorite characters in the Bible, a Bible hero, and his name is Gideon. Now, all of us know Gideon. He is a war hero, right? He is a prophet. He is a judge, a general. And we know that famous story. Right? What's the famous story? How many people did he take to war? You know, Bible study or not? 300 people he took to war. Wow! As a kid, as a youth, in your Bible study, like, we would use the fascinating story of Gideon. You can overcome things in your life. If Gideon can do it with 300 people, you can do it too. Wow! Thank you, Jesus. Right? But it does not make sense. Logically, how can you win a war with 300 people? You don't see it happening with the countries today, right? We can only prepare in our army, in Tentera Darat Malaysia, kita ada 300 orang sahaja, yeah? No, you don't see that happening. Logically, it's a very bad strategy. Very bad war strategy, battle strategy. It doesn't make sense. But Gideon obeyed and honored God. Defied logic, and then achieved that peace from God. And then he won the war. Now, it's pretty crazy. Sometimes we just skim through this, skim through the story of Gideon, and we just think that Gideon is another good story in the book of Judges. Oh, wow! Such a nice story about Gideon. But this morning, I want to zoom in on a conversation between Gideon and God. A crucial conversation between Gideon and God that I believe that all of us could learn and apply in our lives. So going to Judges chapter 7, verse 2 to 4. If you have your Bibles, you can turn your Bibles to Judges chapter 7, verse 2 to 4. I'm reading from the NLT version, the New Living Translation. Are you guys there yet? Okay. So it says here, the Lord said to Gideon, "You have too many warriors with you. If I let all of you fight the Midianites, the Israelites will boast to me that they saved themselves by their own strength." So here, we've seen that God is telling Gideon, there are too many people. And right from the start, God already foresee the pride issue. And said, hey, if you guys win, you're going to forget about me. So here is God addressing a pride issue. And verse 3, therefore, tell the people, whoever is timid or afraid, they may leave this mountain and go home. So 22,000 of them went home, leaving only 10,000 who were willing to fight. Now, let's pause here for a moment. Logically, I still can win a war with 10,000 people. Logically, if I've got 10,000 ringgit in my bank, I feel kind of safe. I can do a lot of things. Logically, with 10,000 people, in Bahasa we say sedikit, lama jadi. Why? Slowly defeat people. Yay, I will get there. Logically, right? But it's crazy. God say there are still too many people in verse 4. Still too many people. Crazy also to know that with 300 people, Gideon took down 135,000 people. And it's recorded in the book of Judges. You can go back and read it in Judges 8, verse 10. 135,000 people. It doesn't make sense. But Gideon honored and obeyed God in that process. But here in this conversation this morning is where I want to zoom in on. I believe God is telling us there are still too many things in your life. There are still too many past baggages from 20 years ago that you're still carrying till today in 2024. There's still too many words and lies that you've told yourself or maybe received from others that you're carrying till today. There's still too many obstacles, still too many problems and issues. But I want to tell you, church, we are familiar with all the negativity. We are familiar with all the problems and issues, and we know what to do. So whenever we are faced with problem, what do? We pray. Thank you very much. 100 points, right? We pray. Oh God, help us. And we know, especially for us Christians for a long time, it's inbuilt in our system to come before God and pray. But this morning, can we be honest with ourselves? Maybe God is saying, there are still too many good things in your life. Good things that are a distraction to you. Maybe there are too many good opportunities that's hindering you from serving God. Too many good opportunities leading you to talk to someone. Too many good things in life. And if we can be honest with ourselves, sometimes the good things distract us. Maybe for some of us, I'm in a relationship. This guy or this girl's too good for me. But you know this person is not meant for you. Maybe they're not a Christian or different culture, different background. And the Holy Spirit is prompting you, time to move on. Oh, but Holy Spirit, there are too many good memories. The first time we held hands, the first time we kissed. So many good memories you cannot let go. Or maybe your workplace. God says, it's time to move on for some of you. Oh God, there are too many good opportunities here to make money. But you are in a toxic work environment. You know that, again, I want to give a disclaimer here. For some people, God will say, stay on in the company. Don't get me wrong, right? But for some, God might be saying, time to move on. Oh my God, how is it going to be like? My family, my future. Real legit concerns. Too many good opportunities that hindered us. And I wonder this morning if we can really be honest with ourselves. Because when it comes to the negative circumstances, obstacles, we know we can come before God. Very easy, in fact. But when it's the good things, the money is good, but bribes all-time high. Oh, the relationship is good, but the sin that has been collected all-time high. There are still too many. Too many, what I want, Lord, I'm not done yet. And God is calling you, challenging you. Too many, God, it's not me. It's meant for Auntie Jack, God. Auntie, you call Auntie Jack, not me, God. It's Uncle Simon, God, not me, God. Too many of that. The Cambridge Dictionary defines logic as a particular way of thinking. All right, a particular way of thinking, especially one that is reasonable and based on good judgment. Reasonable and based on good judgment. That's how logic is, how logic works. So many people have stopped God from doing something in their life because it's reasonable and based on good judgment. Let me say it again. So many of us have stopped God from speaking to us, challenging us, pushing us because it's reasonable and good judgment. And so what happens? We have now come to a point in our life where we live and create this logic based on our imperfections and the remnants of God's goodness. Let me say this again. We've come to a point in our life because, the good, the logic becomes our compass to guide in our life. So what happens? We live and create a logic for ourselves based on our imperfections and remnants of God's goodness. I've got a slide for this. It's dangerous, guys, if we live in a world today where we are living based on our logic, filled with our imperfections, thinking that we can do it. I think I have a slide for this, right? Sorry. And the remnants of God's goodness. So what happened? We pick and choose. Oh, God, this is good for me. Take. God, this is not good for me. Mm-mm, I don't want. And the Holy Spirit is pounding at your door. Come on, it's time for you to move. No, God. And we live in this logic. And this morning, if we can all be honest with God, have we allowed our logic to lead us astray? Now, don't get me wrong. I'm not encouraging us to be reckless. I'm not encouraging us to not use common sense. Don't get me wrong. But I think something is wrong when we use our logic, when our logic goes before God, then isn't that disobedience as well? And that's what I want to present to all of you this morning. A couple years ago in me, we were planning to move back to Alostar. So my wife and I, we were based in KL. We were with a church here in KL, and I was a youth pastor there. I negotiated with God. I haggled with God. I had to like, God, are you sure? Because there were so many good people, right? Too many good people with good intentions. I have to give this disclaimer. Too many good people with good intentions. Then, you sure you want to be a pastor so early? Ah? Then, are you sure you want to move back to Alostar? Nothing one all. Mind you, these are people with good intentions. Then, you are meant for KL and more. Do you know that? Wow, thank the Lord. Wow, you're like, God, is that you, Lord? You're speaking, right? But I remember in my personal time with God, I remember God saying to me, Dan, give me the best years of your life. Give me the best years of your life. And I had to go through my journey of defying every logic there is and say, God, I'm going to choose to obey you. And because of that obedience, we have a thriving community of young people who are on fire for God. Can we give God a big hand? And not just that, we have many first-generation Christians. That means their parents are still non-Christians. But this 14-year-old, 15-year-old, 16-year-old that 4 years ago we met, made that decision and said, I'm going to follow Jesus. Logically, it doesn't make sense because my parents believe in another idea. My parents believe in another belief system. But they defied their logic and they choose to put God first. Today, their families are blessed because of them. Can we give them a big hand? Have we created and live in a logic that is filled with our imperfections and God, remnants of God's goodness? And we just skim through life. This morning, I want to invite somebody all the way from Alostar, because I want you to hear her story. So, can we give a big hand to Tasha?
One more time. guys. I'm Tasha. I'm 18 this year, and I've just finished my SVM a few weeks ago. It was a stressful moment for me during the exam. Most of my friends had already stopped their activities so that they can focus just on their studies. My dream is to score straight A's. But I still continue going to church and serving regularly, and also attending our tribe's gathering, which is our CGs, every week, even during exam. Some people might question me, why are you still going to church and serving? And aren't you afraid you don't have enough time to study? Or why do you take your academics so lightly? Shouldn't you focus on your study first? The only reason that I made this decision is because I want to honor God first. My story is a bit unique compared to my friends back at Seoul. While most of them came from non-Christian families, I grew up in church and I know how church works. But seeing how my pastors and my friends intentionally reach out and loving others that are never know Jesus, it pushes me to be creative in telling the story of Jesus to my school friends and other young people that I know. Other than being part of the pastoral team, I'm also passionate with the kids. There's a picture, I think. Next. And another one. Okay. There's a few kids in our community. They are invited by Ayla, which is PDSK, my pastor, eldest daughter. I meet up with them after service and have a small discussion with them every week. And one day, one of the girls who is 8 years old comes from a non-Christian family. She went home and told her mom that she loves coming to church. And she tell her family that she wants to become a Christian also. She wants to know more about Jesus. When I heard that story, how brave that girl is, I felt so happy by her. God's ways might not always be the path I wanted. I could choose not to serve, not going to church. I have also had the right to say that I will have more time after SPM to serve. But I choose to honor God first. Yes, it may require me to work harder to balance on both sides, but it is worth it. Absolutely, yes. I honor God through my studies and I find peace during exams. I believe I can't do my exam without God. Whenever I feel stressed or tired, I turn to His Word to find peace and strength. I'm also blessed to have a community that encourages me and prays for me too. I've learned that there is no such thing as the right timing to honor God. It is God above my logic. I want to encourage all of you, don't be afraid. God has greater plans for you. Put Him first and all things will be given to you as well. Thank you.
Come on guys, you can clap better than that. Let's give Tasha a big hand. Tasha, okay ma? You know, Tasha comes from a cluster school. You know, it's a scholar cluster, right? And it's one of a famous school in Alostar. Like your UPSR has got to be straight A's to enter that school. And she is in that environment. So logically, her friends will be studying in a weekend. Logically, her Christian friends will be taking time off. Now, again, I want to be very, very careful this morning. I am not promoting us to be reckless. I'm not promoting a cause for us to put away all common sense. No. I'm asking us to put God first. You see, I challenge the students, right? No point you get straight A, but your character are all E's and F. And I mean, students here, I'm sure uncle, aunties, you kind of know as well, right? There's some students out there who want A's. A students, you all want A's, right? but they will cheat. They will lie. I mean, we've heard stories before of how some parents who would find ways to buy the SPM paper so that they can prepare. Have you heard that before? I want to tell you, even from my time when I started with SPM, it's quite scary. Hey, we might have to retake the paper. What happened? Paper leak. Wow, lao eh, like, what's going on? And I think this year's SPM was the sejarah paper, right? There was apparently like a leak. Wow, Tasha was like, no, God, please, no more. I don't want to retake this paper. But there are people out there who are like that. We live in a world like that. But hey, again, it's not putting aside, right, being reckless, putting aside our common sense, but choosing to honor God. The story that Tasha shared earlier about this 8-year-old girl, she's really cute. She's an amazing girl. So her parents' context are still not Christians, right? And recently, her cousin also is one of my leaders, a youth in our church. And one day she's like, oh, Pastor DK, I don't know what's happening now. I think there's a fight at home. I say, what happened? Yeah, my mother is questioning me. My auntie also questioning me. Why I bring, you know, this little cousin to church? I say, what happened? Tell me what happened. So she was fighting with her mommy. And then she told her mommy, she said, mommy, do you know Jesus is more important than you? Aiya! And then in the conversation, I want to tell you it's serious, because then the mom is like, what are they teaching them in church? And then because she's just 8 years old, she just want to win the argument. You know kids, right? They want to win the argument. She's like, you know, right? It's because of Jesus. That's why I'm in your life. Jesus put me in your belly. These are the obstacles that I have to face. And we're like, and so I had to talk to her. I was like, hey, I want you to know, Pastor Daniel is very proud of you. You stood up for Jesus. But you cannot use Jesus' name like that. Your mommy don't understand. But what's fascinating is that this eight-year-old girl understands the concept of God, understands the sovereignty of God, understands who God is in her life. And yeah, I know, I'm not standing by it. She used it against her mom. Telling her mom that it's because of Jesus I am in your life shouldn't be the way. But think about it. Her view of God. And didn't the Bible tell us, didn't Jesus say, those who enter the kingdom of heaven should have a childlike faith? But the older we get, logic becomes stronger. Have we lived and created this life of logic based on our imperfections, our experiences, our wins in life, and remnants of God's goodness? And whenever God is trying to speak to you, whenever God is trying to call you out to something greater, you push away, you pull back. Another story of this young man that we know in our church. When we first met him, he's very quiet, and get to journey with him, and I found out that his parents are going through a divorce. And in fact, it's a very, very messy divorce. Messy in the sense where it got physical between the father and mom. And imagine like a 15-year-old boy, 16-year-old boy, having to witness whenever the parents go through a physical altercation at home. And him being a big size, like my size, yeah, kind of big for a 16-year-old, he would protect his mom. He would get physical with his dad as well in that process. Now, most of us here would be like, well, that's a good thing, protecting his mom and whatnot. And he had a lot of issues of anger, temper. But because of this community, he came to church. I want to tell you, it's no walk in the park. Parents are still not Christian. And had to journey with him and pray for him. And thank God, he gave his heart to Christ and he began to learn about Jesus. I want to tell you, he's not a perfect boy. Still learning what it is. But one day, out of the blue, remember, the mom is not a Christian, yeah? One day, out of the blue, the mom called me and said, hi, Pastor Daniel. He said, I witnessed my son grow up in front of me. 我看到我的儿子长大在我的面前. She said that in Mandarin. I was like, wow. I said, what do you mean? What happened? So apparently there was another physical altercation. Now, instead of this boy fighting back with the dad, throwing punches, he received the blows and stopped it. The mom was perplexed, like, why do you do that? And so after when everything calmed down, the mom asked him. The mom said, why? Why didn't you fight back? Why did you just ding chu ba liao? Chinese, right? Ding chu. He said, because that's what Jesus would do. The mom cried. The mom said, thank you so much. I won't be here this morning. I won't be able to share with you this story that God is doing in Alostar if my wife and I weren't obedient, defied every logic there is to leave KL and to move back to Alostar. It's not easy, church. Can I be honest with you this morning? It's hard when I see my friends drive the car that I want. It's hard to see when my friends are going on a holiday with their family, like how I want, like how I imagined as a young boy. It's hard to see my peers having finer things in life. Church, can we be real this morning? I'm not promoting us to be materialistic or anything, but you know what I'm talking about. We are human. Sometimes you scroll through Instagram and Facebook, I'm like, wow, Lord, you're blessing them, huh? What are we doing here? It's hard. And we negotiate with God. I negotiate with God. I say, God, come on, God. I remember back then when I was still working. I said, God, I'm in a worship team. I come 6 in the morning. I'm here, God. And as a CG leader, I the one of the last to leave as well. In those days, if you're in my CG, you're like, oh, yo, this Pastor DK, I have to wait for him. Always talking to people, telling them. And this is my negotiation with God. I say, God, it's not that I didn't give you my best. I gave you my best, you know. Wow, building fund season. God, I'm just a student. I also give, God. Come on, God, you should understand what I've done, right? I have sacrificed. I've given everything I've got, Lord. My wife and I, God, we've sacrificed so much. Remember our sacrifice, right? Romans chapter 12, we're a living sacrifice. God, you know my intentions, God. Oh, we cry before God. But there's one hard truth that I had to learn. And that is obedience is better than sacrifice. See, some of us today, you haggle with God. God, you know I give the best tithe and offering. You know my heart, God. I give the church. But maybe God is calling you to serve in the kids ministry or the youth ministry. Some of you, God, I've been serving. I've been giving my best. And God is challenging you to honor Him with your money, which is very hard for you to do. See, this I believe. Every one of us has a unique relationship with God. And God is calling you uniquely into your destiny, to greatness. Something for you. There is no one size fit all. It cannot be like, I come to church, oh, God spoke to Joel like that, means God spoke to me too. It doesn't work that way. But that's what I meant by we live and create in a logic based on our imperfections, our experiences. Oh, this is what happened to Uncle Michael. Oh, God spoke to him. Oh, I like that. I keep it for my life. Oh, Auntie Jack, what you shared just now, the prophecy that God said to you? Oh, I like that. I keep it for me. And here is God banging at your door. My child, I am talking to you. Listen. But you choose to put your logic first. Can we honor God before our logic today? Can I have the musicians, please? Can we play the song, I'll Trust? Obedience is better than sacrifice. I want to end with this story in the Bible. Another character that we are all familiar with. And his name is King Saul. In 1 Samuel chapter 15, it tells us a story of God asking Samuel to tell King Saul about destroying the Amalekites. And if you read the story, you know the Amalekites, they are some nasty people. They were bullies. They were hurting the people of God. And God told, hey, you know what, Saul? It's time to get rid of all of them. But there was an instruction, my God. Saul, I want you to eliminate everything. Nothing left behind. Because they were evil people. Now, this was back in the day, right? And the Amalekites, they were just bullies. They were just pushing their way through, hurting people. And so in the story, takes a very interesting turn. Saul acted on his own logic. So if you have Bibles, you can turn with me to 1 Samuel chapter 15. You can fix your eyes on the screen. I have the verse as well. And we're going to go through it together. 1 Samuel chapter 15, reading from verse 10. Then the Lord said to Samuel, I am sorry that I ever made Saul king. Pause here for a while. I pray that God will never tell us this. I'm so sorry for making you. I know today we live by the grace of God. But when I read this, I'm like, God, am I obedient to you? Am I just living in my logic? Because God, I would never want to hear this from you. But this is what God said to Samuel. I'm very sorry I made Saul king, for he has not been loyal to me and has refused to obey my command. Samuel was so deeply moved when he heard this that he cried out to the Lord all night. Samuel didn't sleep. Samuel prayed. Verse 12. Early the next morning, Samuel went to find Saul. Someone told him, Saul went to the town of Carmel to set up a monument to himself. Pause here for a while. It's funny, right? When we keep living based on our logic, pride is just right around the corner. Here is Saul building a monument of himself. I did it. I am the king who defeated the army. And in this story, he spared King Agag's life. Not because it was God's call, but it was based out of his logic. And that logic led to his pride. Build a monument for himself. Then verse 13, when Samuel finally found him, Saul greeted him cheerfully. This cheerfully here is not happy. This cheerfully here is prideful, cynical. Cheerfully, he told Samuel, may the Lord bless you. He said, I've carried out the Lord's command. Lies. Right? Then verse 14. Then what is all the bleating of sheep and goats and the lowing of cattle I hear? Samuel demanded. And then, this is the part where Saul could have been like, ayah, I should better say sorry lah. But what did he say? Yeah, it's true that the army spared the best of the sheep, goats and cattle. Best. Isn't it strange? When you live based out of your logic, it's never your fault. It's someone else's fault. So what do we see here now? King Saul, Tai Chi, pushed the blame to his army. My army, you know, so I admitted. But they are going to sacrifice them for the Lord your God. Wow, cantik lah. So daring, telling Samuel this. We're going to sacrifice this one. Don't worry about it. We've destroyed everything else. Then Samuel said to Saul in verse 16, stop! Listen to what the Lord told me last night. What did he tell you? Saul asked. And Samuel told him, although you may think little of yourself, are you not the leader of the tribes of Israel? That is a reminder to King Saul that it's not his authority but God's authority first. As a leader of the tribe of Israel, the Lord has anointed you king of Israel, and the Lord sent you on a mission and told you, go and completely, the word here is completely destroy the sinners until they are all dead. Verse 19, why haven't you obeyed the Lord? Why did you rush for the plunder and do what was evil in the Lord's sight? And verse 20, when I begin to read this, my heart just grew sadder and sadder, just imagining myself in Samuel's position. In verse 20, but I did obey the Lord. I just think loud. This is what Saul would say, right? Right? But I did obey the Lord. I carried out the mission he gave. I brought back King Agag, but I destroyed everyone else. Then my troops brought in the best of the sheep, goats, cattle, and plundered the sacrifice to the Lord your God in Gilgal. Interesting. Based on our logic, what do? We blame. We live in our pride. It's never our fault. It's always someone else. Then the heart-hitting truth came in verse 22. But Samuel replied, What is more pleasing to the Lord, your burnt offerings and sacrifice, or your obedience to His voice? Listen, obedience is better than sacrifice, and submission is better than offering the fat of rams. So how many of us have been coming to church week after week after week? And you know what? You have been sacrificing. Not just 1 year, not just 2 years, 10 years, 15 years, 20 years. And here today, it's an honor to be with so many uncles and aunties in faith. But how many of us here have been living in our logic for so long that we don't know the voice of God anymore? We live on our own understanding. Remnants of God's goodness mixed with our life experiences, mixed with that victory you had in your office, that $1 million deal, the $10 million deal, mixed with that, and that has muddled the voice of God. And then at the same time, you meet people with good intentions. And I want to tell you, nothing wrong with people that has good intentions. Problem is us. There's a filter in our ear and our eyes. We want to see what we want to see. We want to hear what we want to hear based on our logic. But today, standing here, I'm so proud of three of you here. You could have said that I could be at home. Mommy and daddy, they believe otherwise. It doesn't make sense for me. But you choose to believe God. You choose to honor God. And you know, us Asian culture, we celebrate all the good results very fast. Hiya, you got straight A's. God bless you. But you know, sometimes working in youth ministry, some of these young people are like, sure, I tell you, character is not there. And then when they come to KL study or go to Penang and study, that's where you see the true colors. That's why we see depression on the rise. That's why we see anxiety on the rise. It starts with us. Today I can stand here proudly, thanking God for my parents who choose to obey. Hey, my parents are not perfect. My dad is a pastor. My mom is in pastoral ministry. They are not perfect. But it was because of their obedience. I am the byproduct of that obedience. And I am able to be obedient unto God today because someone did it. So don't neglect that hosting time and that cha bee hoon and lasagna, because it might be your access to that young person's life. And they see how obedient you are unto God. It doesn't make sense. Logically, you're supposed to rest. Logically, why need to even trouble yourself? Logically, tapao back home lah. But what is God asking you to do? So again this morning, I'm not promoting recklessness. I'm not promoting for us to neglect all common sense. I am promoting the obedience unto God, because obedience is better than sacrifice. You can sacrifice all you want your whole life, but miss out the point, just like King Saul. Logically, what? Okay, what? I spare King Agag's life, right? Okay, what? Logically, I keep the sheep and rams. I can barbecue with my family. Logic, right? But today, can we honor God before logic? Shall we all close our eyes and bow our heads this morning? What's going on in your life? I believe this morning God is telling you there are still too many. Every one of us have a unique, there are still too many. Let me say this again. Every one of us have a unique, there are still too many. And you're carrying a lot of things in your back. Not just painful baggages and past experiences. You know what? Heavy gold medals from your past. Heavy winnings and earnings from your past. And that's created a logic for you. Too many good things that you can't hear the voice of God clearly. This morning, I want to pray for three groups of people. The first group of people, fear has been your friend. So what happened? you've allowed fear to be the compass of your life. So you are very safe. Nothing is happening to you. You're very, very safe. But you're missing out on the opportunities. You're missing out the greatness that is in your life that God has called you to. But you're playing it very, very safe. And it's because of fear. Maybe someone said something they shouldn't have said. Maybe someone has done something they shouldn't have done. This morning, can we come before God? If that is you, as I pray this prayer, why don't you just talk to God? God, this morning, here I am. I'm carrying this fear for far too long. Heal my heart. Make it clean again. God, I forgive those who said all those nasty things and lies. And you know what, God? I even forgive myself, Lord, for telling me all the things that I couldn't have done when you have created me with intention, when I wonderfully and fearfully made, oh God. So God, I come before you right now. God, I want to put my trust in you. I surrender my fear. At your name, amen. The second group of people that I want to pray for with all eyes closed. Your success has been dictating your life. Not God. Your success in how you deal with ministry, your success in your office, maybe your success at home. You're doing so well. And that has led you instead of God. I want to pray for you this morning. God, some of us here, we have allowed our gold medal to dictate us. We have allowed the earnings, we have allowed our life experiences to tell us where we should go. And you know what, God? Some of it is right. But God, have we disobeyed you in that process? God, we don't want to live a life of confusion. We want to live a life of conviction. And this morning we come before you, God, in total surrender. God, we choose to be obedient unto you, to honor you before our logic. At your name we pray, amen. The third group of people, you've been toying with the idea of Jesus. You've heard about the good relationship, but you've never been in a relationship with Jesus. And this morning, I want to pray for you. If that's you, I hope you can pray together with me. Say, dear Jesus, I give you my heart. I receive you. Forgive me for all the things that I've done wrong. I give you my life. At your name we pray, and everybody say, amen. I don't want us to live and create a life based on our logic. And that logic is made up of our imperfections, our experiences, our life achievements, mixed with God, remnants of God's goodness. We won't go far, church. So this morning, can we all rise up to our feet as we worship this with this song? I will trust in you, Lord, for you hear my cry. You are with me in the flood. You are with me to everything in life, oh God. There's no end that can erase every promise that you made. You are faithful in every trust in you, Lord, for you hear my cry. You are with me in the fight. You are with me in the fight. There's no hand that can erase every promise that you made. You are faithful in every season. Let's make this bridge our prayer this morning. What shall I? This is my prayer this morning, God. What shall I fear? God, obeying you is not easy. Obeying you is not easy, God. It's not easy when we were in our teens. It's not easy when we are in our campus life. It's not easy when we are young adults. It's not easy when we are adults and in our senior life. It's not easy to obey you. But I will trust in you, O God. Because whom shall I fear? What shall I fear, O God? For you are with me. God, I pray for NLCC. As they step into obedience, there's going to be an open door. God, the floodgates of heaven will open. We don't want to live based on our logic, haggling our way because of our sacrifices. God, how can we ever compare to your sacrifice? Because you died on the cross, oh God. How can we ever compare? And so, God, we are reminded this morning that obedience is better than sacrifice. And so, God, here we are. We lay it all before you. God, help us. Help us to trust you, oh God. And God, we thank you because we are not alone. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for always being there. God, for some of us, we need a harder knock on the door. So knock the door, oh God. Call us out to greatness, oh Lord. And we will not choose an average life. We will choose greatness, oh God, with you. In Jesus' name we pray, and everybody say, amen. Amen. Give me God a big hand this morning. Thank you so much, NLCC. God bless you all.
Let's give God another clap offering for Pastor Daniel. His powerful sharing. He came not just to share a very good sermon, but his life in obedience, definitely is a testimony. Yes, church, defile not just all odds, yeah, but defile all logics in your life, and go in the obedience to God. And obedience is certainly better than sacrifice. Submission is better than offering, yeah? Why don't we just pray? We want to pray for Pastor Daniel and Pastor Caroline, even as they continue to lead this church soul in Alostar, reaching out to the young people. Come, let's just stretch forth our hands as we pray for them. Father, we want to thank you for Pastor Daniel and Pastor Caroline. Lord, even as they have started this church, Lord, in Alostar, reaching out to the young people, defiling, Lord, all logics, all odds, Lord, in their life, to take heed of this call that you have for them in obedience to you, Lord, starting this church for the young people. Father, we want to thank you, Lord, for their obedience. Lord, even as they continue to minister to these young ones, Lord, in Alostar, Father, we just pray, Lord, that you will enable them. Father, you will provide for every of their need, O Lord. And Father, Lord, that they will be such beacon of light, O Lord. They will be such oasis, Lord, in the place where you will bring all young people to you and to know you, O Lord. So, Father, we thank you for them. Lord, we are so blessed by what they have shared with us. And Father, we want to take on, Lord, this message, O Lord, to be obedient unto you, O Lord. So, Father, we thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Now I pronounce God's richest blessing, the abundance of his favors, his amazing grace to be upon each and every one of you and your family. God bless you. God loves you. And love someone. Amen.